Very warm welcome to all of you in the first open up session of 2021. Today's topic, as Anish already highlighted, that it's about the rising wave in the fintech industry, specifically open banking. And within open banking, we will talk about the most transformative trend, which is the embedded finance. And we have Vivek along with us. A very warm welcome to you as well, Vivek. One second, I'll just
protocol
remove. Okay, I thought. It's better to wear. Yeah, yeah, okay. It's comfortable speaking this way. Okay. So yeah, Vivek, a warm welcome from all of us out here. It's so good to have you in our office.
Thank you.
Vivek, a couple of questions that I have in my mind is, one is that when we talk about open banking initiatives in India or outside India, if we look at the trend outside Indian market, whether it's UK or US, it has been either market-driven or regulations-driven, right? But India has sort of taken a hybrid approach where both the market as well as the regulatory authorities, they play a vital role in building up this open banking ecosystem, right? And while API banking, is catching up, the open banking is catching up, fintechs has been the prime consumer of it, the end consumer. But when we talk about embedded finance, which is largely the non-financial service provider, building their financial products, right? It is, to take an example, maybe Ola Money or, Google launching their pay option on the Google parking, basically to book Google parking on the maps, right? When we talk about this, what role, we would want to understand from the banker's perspective as to what opportunities do you see in embedded finance, given that mostly it'll be the non-fintech firms, driving the embedded finance wave.
Yeah, thanks Gunjan, thanks Anish for the intro. Welcome, thanks for hosting me here. So basically, if you ask me what's the opportunity here, huge. So this sectoral boundaries are blurring, right? So any sector that you take, e-com, travel, education, etc. So the sectoral boundaries wherein embedded finances are coming is kind of blurring. You see finance or payments being embedded into the user journeys without even the customer realizing, right? So if you say e-com is a classic example, wherein you go, you shop, you pay, maybe you take a loan, you don't know that you have taken a loan. So that is a customer experience that we have brought about, wherein the strength of embedded finance lies in the customer experience or customer not knowing what is happening or not knowing that there's a banking transaction of a loan, account getting opened, a disbursement being happening, and an EMI, whatever required for the EMI is being initiated. So opportunities are huge. So if you see today, everything is turning digital across sectors. Whichever sector you are in, there's a payment for sure. And if the payment is of a minimum value, there's an opportunity for lending. And when you embed all these payment, lending, and on a separate note, even investments or growing your money, huge opportunities. How well you embed it to enhance the experience of the customer will change the game.
Got it. So Vivek, you mentioned about payments and lending, right? And primarily that has been the drivers for the first wave of embedded finance. We could see any e-commerce companies integrating payment aggregators and even maybe enabling buy now, pay later option primarily of lending, right? That sort of drove the first wave of embedded finance. In the second wave, you spoke about, investments or wealth management as well. In that, like, how do you see the role of these existing payment aggregators changing, or do you see what role would they play in this second wave?
Primarily, payment aggregators bring in scale. So even though we do some innovations here and there, the kind of network strength that these aggregators possess, right, it helps in a larger adoption of whatever use case we bring in. So BNPL, it actually started off like 2 years, two, 3 years back. Now the kind of adoption we have in buy now, pay later is huge. It has multiple effects, right? Across card or any other UPI or any other payment category, if you see, BNPL is a hot topic now. So payment aggregators for me definitely scale, and that too innovation across. Even though the innovation might be sparking at some fintechs or some bank houses, with payment aggregators you can achieve scale and adoption. And with the learnings that they have in this field, right, a lot of streamlining and improvements on top of whatever is being innovated also comes in.
Got it. Thanks. So, Vivek, one is we took an example of the first wave of embedded finance being driven by payments and lending as well. But largely, if we look at the fintech landscape, it is now the sector is evolving into an API-based collaborative approach through open banking. Like on one hand, we have UPI that was launched in 2016 that sort of allows individuals to access their bank accounts or make transactions through third-party apps, largely through Google Pay, Phone Pay, and on the other hand, we have new banking players simplifying the life of consumers or businesses as well to streamline the business finance and create different business models. So in such a landscape or much change environment, what it was before, how does the role of a traditional bank change over here?
Yeah, great. So as you initially talked, right, so we have a hybrid model. Even though we say that open banking in India is industry-driven, but there's a clear-cut regulatory overview on how fintech can play around here or open finance can play around in the Indian market. So one classic example I always tell is, see, in the last two decades, there were only four entities which were given banking license. Why this is a very, very tightly managed sector is because it's there for everyone to see, because you're dealing with public money. Creating experiences around how finance services are consumed. There's a larger way of handling customers' money. There's a asset liability function which the bank does, risk management function that bank does. And regulator, considering a holistic view and considering the different social, sectoral, or different customer segments that the services are being offered to, or else different use cases that is being taken up by these fintechs. The regulations are for all, right? So when fintech or an open banking use case comes about, we should also be thinking what are the existing regulations, how these regulations are evolving, and what is the intention behind these regulations. Coming back to the point on UPI, so UPI presents a clear framework on how an open banking model can evolve in the payment space. So there's a role for an NPCI, there's a role for RBI, there's a role for the bank, and there's a role for a third party application provider like for the likes of Google Pay or Phone Pay. So that model is very clear. The framework is established, and within the rules of the game, people innovate, and we have seen the results. When it comes to other evolving neobanks, etc., right, there is no regulated definition for neobank. Even for that matter, in India, there is no regulated definition for open banking. Even as students of this fintech ecosystem, you and me know open finance or open banking means different things for different people. I mean, if you see Google, you will get PSD2 or the EU directives on open banking. In here, what we kind of, in our discussions, what we term as open banking is generally, wherever the customer is, you provide financial services, not necessarily from the bank's own interface, physical or otherwise. So wherever the customer is, as I said earlier, in a Flipkart or a Amazon checkout, you are there providing loan, or you are providing payment experience in all the apps that's out there. So that distinction you'll have to be mindful about. And as you said, what role does traditional banks play or should play? Traditional banks play in this regulatory environment, as I said, the account is held by the bank, the transaction liability is held by the bank. And for that matter, the trust factor is kind of safeguarded by the bank. Having said that, there is enough room for innovation, there is enough room for collaboration and partnerships. And within the game, as a safeguarder of all these rules in place and to ensure customer money is safe and all those stuff, how do we innovate? How do we ensure that the fruits of open banking use cases are let out to the customers? So in simple terms, maybe what traditional banks does is ensure rules are followed, give space for fintechs to innovate.
Vivek, you mentioned there's enough room for collaboration, right? Whether it's fintechs collaborating with banks or banks taking the sort of route through new banking platform to drive the mass adoption as well. So in this case, while we do understand the challenges that probably a fintech partner would face, I think this is the question that all of us would have in mind. What, as a bank, what are the challenges you face given that right now Federal has partnered with EpiFi as well, which is another new banking platform for consumers, and maybe a fintech player like Rupeek. So we would want to hear from your, what's your perspective and what are the challenges that banks face while collaborating or partnering with such players?
rather than challenges, efforts are there from both sides, and if the minds meet, I think it's possible. I would say that what we normally see as challenges is the landscape is fast evolving. So when Anish and I discuss about a model in 2018, and 6 months later the entire regulation and the model around it changes. So within 6 months, that is just 2 quarters for the bank, right? Within six months, the technology in a bit changed, the regulatory environment changed, market conditions changed, competition changes. In a fast-paced world, especially we have a traditional bank setting on how different processes needs to be carried out. How do we ensure we do not miss the game, ensure competitive delivery of products and support new innovations? That has been one challenge, but again, that's a challenge not really restricted to one bank, it's across the industry. And within the constraints, how do you play and give a good results will make or break the game. That has been my experience. And with respect to fintechs, one common element I've seen is tech competency is a given. My personal belief is that bank has a certain set of core strengths. Fintech bring a certain set of skill sets. How much you can appreciate and imbibe those, and vice versa. So bank has a set of skill sets. Maybe not that flashy when it comes to risk management or any other terms of regulatory compliance and all other rules. So even if you go by specific example, right? The manner, the frequency, the tone in which customer communication needs to be carried out is being mandated by the regulator. So we need to follow that. So both, again, so the fintech also imbibing the spirit of what the bank puts across as conditions or what is required from a banking service delivery point of view in a market like India. And if both minds meet and respects each other, I think a lot of challenges can be overcome.
Got it. Vivek, given that to drive the mass adoption of open banking, right, on one hand, it'll be the banks directly exposing the APIs. And given, considering embedded finance, as I said, and you rightly highlighted, it'll be driven by non-fintech firms mostly. So this driving factor would be, do you think that it'll be directly be given by the bank, or which route would they choose, whether it'll be the banks or with the fintechs, because both would be sort of, driving the mass adoption. But for the non-fintech firms, what's your take and how would it be driven?
I mean, my sense is always been the product will speak for itself. But only thing is that the initial push that a VC-powered fintech can provide would be a boost. And also the strength of the traditional bank, there's a branch network traditionally being built, that also could play a role. But net-net, if the product is solid, there will be takers for sure. And if you see, there are a lot of inefficiencies in the various financial services in the country today, and fintechs are there to solve it. And as much you solve, there are takers for your use case. And I think, and if both, as I said, if both minds come together and work for a push on this master adoption, it will help. But even, as I said, there's a advantage from the fintech community also because of the way their new age techniques in which they reach to customers, or for that matter, deep pockets powered by VCs. All those things would be positively impacting the adoption.
Got it. So you mentioned about fintechs providing seamless experience as well. And given that you've been in the banking industry for a long time, while a bank needs to partner with a fintech, what are the parameters or the strengths that you look for while picking or choosing a fintech partner for mass adoption of any initiatives? Maybe open banking only, let's take.
Basically, synergies. Right, so if I have a good competitive product in the SME category, I may not be really keen to, if my product is competitive and I'm kind of innovating on that space, maybe the scope for innovation or that synergy for innovation may be lacking. So that synergy is one thing, it should not cannibalize my existing product plans. It should be kind of complementing to each other. So there's some skill set that the product feature which the fintechs brings in, which is kind of for the bank a gap to be filled in, then it makes sense. Separately, what we look for in fintechs is while all these synergies and all other business constructs fall in place, I have observed is, again, tech competency is there. It has never been lacking with any of those fintechs. But again, going back to my earlier reference to why a regulator has been able to give only 4 banking licenses in the last 20 years. There's more to do with, more than tech, there are a lot of other factors that come in, right? You're dealing with customer money. So how much deeper is a partnership, the kind of due diligence you need to undertake on the partner also needs to be considered, right? So that is one factor. So separately, we are all in the digital era. How much of information security practices that you follow, customer data privacy, data protection, how much of those guidelines are we effectively following? When maybe a lot of action happens around how do we make the user journey more efficient or more foolproof. But there is a lot of boring but yet very solid work that needs to be happening at the back end to ensure that the data protection, informed consent, all these aspects, subtle aspects are taken more seriously. So across different InfoSec priorities or compliance or due diligence or what this entity is made up of, what are their plans, etc. So there are a lot of due diligence activities which banks should be mindful about across different domains. InfoSec, just to take an example. So all these are not good to have, it is must to have. So across, some of these things are confidential checklists for each banks. So that is also a very important factor.
That gives us a lot of insights. I'll actually open the room for audience and make it more interactive. Any questions, guys?
Hi, Vivek. When you were discussing about the embedded finance, right? Just wanted to understand, where do you see a more potential of the rising embedded finance? Is it towards the consumer segment, like B2C or the B2B segment?
Coming in an open discussion, bank opens discussion, I cannot say B2C, but my inclination is towards B2C, but a lot of action is happening in B2B, I know. And the work that you guys have done is amazing. So both, there is potential and there are inefficiencies or innovations, inefficiencies to be addressed and innovations potential in both the categories. But depends on the sector you're focusing, right? So maybe currently I might be deeply working on a retail use case. So I know inside out of what is happening in there, what competitions are doing, what will come in 2021, 2022. Very briefly, I know what are the potential in B2B category also, the kind of SME or corporate use cases or embedded finance that is happening. It may not take a mass scale. Maybe people may not talk, like everyone knows a PhonePe or a Google Pay today. But when you talk about Khata Book also people know. When you talk about a merchant app or a merchant portal, it may not have the noise that you see in the market like a retail use case would have. That's the only difference. Possibilities are there in both.
Hi, Vivek. Thanks for joining us today. You mentioned, in Europe there are regulations like PSD1, PSD2, etc. Given India's present position from a regulatory stance, the fact that we don't have any clear regulation on this front, do you see it more as an opportunity or as a risk? And do you think it's better this way, or would we be better off with a regulation with specified boundaries on how open banking should be done in India?
Ideally, regulations, if there's there's certainty and predictability in the regulation, that's always welcome. As you know, there are some gray areas, but if you see, regulators are catching up. And while we go through this dilemma, right, we define a new innovative process or a product, and there is lack of clarity in the regulation. So that is a risk anyway you'll have to take. But having said that, if you go behind the intent of the existing regulation, you can connect the dots and you know, okay, basis this product for which there is no regulation at hand, maybe this is a way to go. So that is how, we have seen, I've personally experienced this dilemma quite a number of times. So, but if you go back from, if you be in the shoes of the regulator and see, in this scenario, new scenario, as a regulator, what would be the action that you take? And if you follow that line in your product roadmap, then it helps and it can be of de-risk. And you see, right, for example, video KYC was launched last January, but even 6 months, 9 months prior to that, people in the industry knew there will be a digital onboarding solution that will come into play. So we can, if you are following the market closely, regulator closely, we know what is coming and whatever is the condition with which those things will be coming. So that will help in any innovative companies like such as yours. In your product delivery, have this thought.
In fact, account aggregation will also be pointing towards that.
Yeah, account aggregation is anyway, I mean, at least four or five banks are doing the POC. Its structure is there. Use cases are kind of, it is opening up a lot of innovation possibilities already there. So account aggregator is the relative stuff to the PSD2 that is there in the EU. But open finance, open banking, etc. is kind of different from what the PSD2 guidelines are, right? Embedded finance, etc. are use cases. That's what I said. There is no clear-cut Indian context. In the Indian regulator context, there is no definition for neobank or open banking. So that when you'll have to understand the use case and the perspective when people use these terms out of context.
Hi, Vivek. Yeah, hi. Thank you for taking your time to come to Open. My question for you is, among all the banking APIs that are offered under embedded finance, right from cards to account creation APIs, which are the ones that banks see most traction on?
I always go by the business at hand or the use case at hand, right? So whether it's card or account, APIs are just a transactional layer in making sure whatever is the business or the product objective. Technically, the APIs take care of that part. It's a boring part. So once you have the pipes in order, whatever needs to flow through that, it will flow. But the business use case or the construct, so when you say card or when you say account, so there's a clear, again, regulatory guideline on what a BIN sponsorship is, what is a partner's role, what are the boundaries of partnerships, what partner can do. Again, transaction liability, settlement liability, who are the players in the game, clear guidelines are there. Specific to account, only bank can hold customer's account, no one else. There are here and there some use cases have been agreed by regulator in terms of wallet, etc. It has its own limit and there's a linking to it, the original bank account also. So all this KYC, bank account, customer onboarding, customer due diligence, all these things are tightly coupled to licensed banks in India. On top of the existing banks, within whatever regulator permits and within wherein there's an option for innovation and some improvements in inefficiencies, etc., fintechs come, collaborate, they bring out new models. So as I said, even though it is industry driven in India, there is no concept of a license given to non-banking entities to perform banking. Customer due diligence, customer account holding, transaction, etc. are core banking functions, right? So even in the, sorry to take this example the third time, when I talked about only four entities given banking licenses in the last 20 years, one of them almost failed. And when we talk about fintechs, right, there are hundreds of fintechs in the last 1.5 years, there are hundreds of fintechs that have failed. So if you go behind reason on why it failed, it was not intentional. Some of the foundational aspects were not clear. It was either not aligned with the regulatory landscape or else whatever wow factor it was created, it could not endure the 3-month period for the customer's journey. Just because you reduce the TAT for onboarding by a few seconds or a minutes does not sustain the user in that app for long. So that is also a classic case study of to learn why different models and fintechs or even banks failed. And that will help in our model also as we work on various ones.
Hi, Vivek. Where we talked about a lot of opportunity and potential in embedded finance, and as you rightly said, the regulatory landscape is sort of still evolving. I just want to understand what are sort of the risks that you as a federal bank or a traditional bank see, and also from the consumer point of view, and how you sort of plan for it with the new models evolving.
Yeah, that's what I said. So if you know, understand how the ecosystem is shaping, it helps. So if you are from a traditional mindset, whatever regulations are out there, and from those regulations, if you try to devise your product, right, you will be limited. A lot of innovations that we are doing, right, even if you consider some of the products which even Open has brought out 2 years back. If you see, is there a guideline out there? Is there an RBI circular wherein you can refer to what is the operational guidelines around such models? It is not there. But that is where, when I said, in that case, innovation is not possible. But you know where is the line and what should not be crossed. And from whoever is working in the industry knows, in which all areas it's a big no-no, and which all areas there is some room for innovation. So that experience and that knowledge base is important, especially when you're trying to innovate or trying to build a new product wherein there is no reference. So neobanking is a classic story, right? So UPI is a reference framework for payments under the guise of NPCI, wherein there's a payment protocol, there's a bank who is supporting the payment, there's a third-party application provider who is interfacing with the customer. That we may extrapolate it to a neobanking use case, but again, it's not just payment. Customer money is there, customer sourcing is there, a lot of important basic functions are there. So we'll have to understand the regulations, and within whatever is available, we'll have to devise our product stack. Until, otherwise, we'll run the risk of regulator coming and shutting the shop.
Vivek, so this, I was looking at the designation, the head of open banking. So while RBL and Yes Bank was the first to come up with an API banking as a business unit, we still don't have too many banks which has a separate API banking or open banking as a. So what led maybe Federer and some of the other banks which you have been doing to come up with this as a, I mean, I think there were a few banks which would have actually had a open bank as a separate business unit. So what led this thought process?
Basically, to stay relevant, in the sense, see, today, again, if even 10 years back, if I ask a millennial crowd like this, no one would have seen a bank branch. From a bank branch to a bank-owned software, whether it is a portal or a mobile banking app, use cases are like, banking is consumed in user journeys of the customer and not in apps owned by the bank. So it is basically providing banking services where the customer is present. Customer is present in WhatsApp, customer is present in Insta, customer is present in Amazon. Customer is not going to come into X bank portal and do his stuff. You have to present your services in a secure, easy, friendly manner wherever the customer is. So that is a notion in which the world is moving. And if you have to stay relevant, APIs are, as I just said, what helps you technically to make that journey possible. How can I get my bank or serve my customer in third-party platforms or interfaces? So APIs are just a layer, and that is a building block. So just like, so even back in my team, when I say, okay, 10 years back, you need to know basic business English, or you need to know basic email or other tools to survive in a corporate setting. API banking, whatever I'm talking, is not technology, it's pure business, and better be ready or equipped with such knowledge. So this is just, again, the summarized answer is for survival.
So last one more question. Understanding APIs, I buy from a business side where we still need to understand the flows and things like that. So how has been that journey generally from the colleagues or people who are working in the API banking unit? Is there specific trainings which you get basically, or is it always because you interact a lot with technology providers or the fintech? So was it a difficult challenge? Or another thing is that does banks specifically look for people from a tech background or a product tech background for this kind of specific business units?
Tech background helps, but you should have a business mindset or a product mindset. Tech alone will not help. So it's basically if you're open to learning, right? So if you, regardless of your background, if you're having your eyes and ears open and open to learning, then that is something that we also internally look in such roles. So again, the boundaries are blurring. You cannot just survive just because you know technology. You cannot survive just because you know business. And for that matter, you, even though you know business and tech, that will not help. You still need to know compliance guideline, what competitors are doing. So all these things are basic requirements. It's not something specialized skill set that you can acquire offhand. So it's something you have to be in the game, understand, talk to people, understand what is happening in the ecosystem. So for example, NPCI itself has a huge real estate, right? Each product is a use case. Each product is a $1 million use case for different companies. So how can I solve or use that to solve the problems of the customer today? In my product, maybe I'm into payments. So at least 4 or 5 huge digital infrastructure is getting built in the payment ecosystem. How much my systems processes are aligned to accept that when it gets eventually launched? So all that thinking, futuristic thinking is required. As you said, technology background is helpful if you have that product mindset also. No, no, it's okay. It's a it's a closed room.
Hi, Vivek. So, as a follow-up question to what Anish asked, banks in general have been slow to move to open banking paradigms. Obviously, there are pioneers. Is it because of the constraints with respect to the legacy infrastructure that is out there? Is it because of intent? Is it because of there's not enough demand from fintechs or other players wanting to consume banking services? Because everybody ends up at the few banks who have been pioneers, but it has been, and it is difficult to open doors, you know, the process, etc. also takes a lot of time. So what do you think on that? Why is it?
I think potential use cases are being supported by across banks, but we have to respect processes also. As I said, bank open stands out, everyone knows it, but there are at least 40-50 players who did not make it to that visibility. They had similar product constructs in their mind. They went for VC pitchings. Some of them did get them, but they did not make it. Now the point is, in 2018 or 2017, when we discuss about bank open, no one knows them. We'll have to go by the process of an internal evaluation to see, okay, what is the competency? What is the product construct? How is the regulation evolving? A lot of things. But given if bank is certain there's a potential and there is synergies around, they'll go all out. But as you said, that, for example, a common complaint I get from the fintech community is that bank is not agile as the partner is. True. But that's what, the strength of the partner may be in agile software development. The strength of the bank may be in processes, regulatory compliance, or for that matter, trust. So how do you etch a partnership to work complementarily and bring out a new product? So that is the key. But I think it's evolving. A lot of banks are giving focus on this domain. They understand it's required for survival, and they are taking steps. At least the top banks I know are really doing a lot of things in this segment.
Hi Vivek, I have a couple of questions on UPI. So first thing, do you think NPCI is trying to build international remittances on UPI, and what are the challenges you see on that? And second thing is there credit possible on UPI, just like an alternative credit card?
First question, it's my personal view. I have not extensively worked on UPI as a product stack, but they are in the works, right? So the UPI model, even Google, for that matter, has kind of proposed it to the American regulator, right? Look what India is doing on UPI. So similar works, similar to UPI, and even NPCI has been requested for consulting assignment across different markets to build similar setup. So that is there. International credit also, some use cases are being worked upon, at least in some of the neighborhood countries, GCC, Singapore, etc. Some use cases are being furthered, as I know. Separately, again, UPI as a credit mechanism, some works are there. Now, in the market today, there are at least three or four players that are getting popular. On the BNPL model, on UPI credit delivery, it is possible. That's again, so consider UPI as a payment channel, and there is a definite framework around what purpose it's to be used for. And you can innovate on whether it is credit or card loading, all these use cases within the rules of the game, you can innovate. And some of the products are out there in the market.
Thank you.
Thank you everyone for making it so interactive. Thanks, Vivek. We really had a great time, and thanks for your insightful session.
Thanks, guys. Thanks for hosting.